Okay, the final talk for this session is titled Texting and Sexual Health, Experimental Evidence from an Information Intervention in Kenya, and is being presented by Risa Kitagawa.
Can everybody hear me? Okay. Hi, my name is Risa Kitagawa. I'm a PhD student in political science at Stanford University. This is actually the first time that I'm presenting this to a specifically ICT4D group, so I'm really looking forward to your reactions and feedback. So today I'm excited to share with you some findings from a randomized field experiment that evaluates the impact of an SMS-based sexual health counseling intervention in Matare, which is an urban informal settlement in Nairobi, Kenya. So I want to begin by talking a little bit about Matare, the context. So it's one of the oldest and largest urban informal settlements in Nairobi. There aren't very good statistics of the demographics here. We're talking about an area of roughly 8 square kilometers, and population estimates range from 200,000 to 750,000. So yeah, grain of salt. But there are a number of development challenges here, we know that much. And in the area of sexual health, we have high rates of STD prevalence, also high rates of early pregnancies, especially when we compare these rates to the general urban prevalence rate. So for the general urban prevalence rate for STDs in Kenya was estimated to be about 17% in 2006. And in the same year, that was estimated to be closer to around 25 to 30% in Matare. So one of the ways that community health counselors in Matare have been trying to tackle these challenges in sexual and reproductive health is to use an SMS counseling service, which allows users to text in a question, any question that they have about sexual and reproductive health, and they receive a response directly from a health counselor to their mobile phone. And the rationale sort of behind this project was that maybe a potential source of these challenges is a lack of access to good, reliable information about sexual health and its consequences. So obviously using SMS in the health space is not unique or new to Matare. I don't think I need to tell this particular audience that there's been an explosive growth of mHealth projects out there. But the question I want to draw your attention to today is, does it matter how the information is being delivered, how the information is packaged? So we know that SMS can be an efficacious way of disseminating health information to a large population, and it can also be cost-effective, or at least as cost-effective as alternatives like calling. But we know much less about how users are actually responding and adapting their behavior based on the information interventions that we're talking about. We have yet to fully understand how the information that's being provided gets translated into health-related behavioral change. And I think it's also important that we distinguish between pushing content and interventions and other kinds of interventions that might have an interactive element to them. And just to preview the findings that I'll be sharing with you today, in some cases, more information actually led people to adopt a riskier sexual behavior. So what are the possible channels of impact? We know offline, at least, so in traditional person-to-person, providing information about risks associated with certain kinds of sexual behavior can curb risky behavior, and this is done in the behavioral economics literature. And we also know from the ICTD literature that ICT can be really good at solving problems of information asymmetry by lowering barriers to obtaining private information. So given that, it seems quite plausible that providing information about sexual health through ICT could achieve the same sorts of results, namely by reducing this or filling this information gap. But the empirical results in the mHealth literature have been mixed. I'm going to be making the case today that we might need features other than just providing access to good information And one of this is one of these is personalization. So personalizing the information. And the second thing that we might need is social cues. And I'll come back to talk a little bit more about these. All right, so the outcomes of interest for this study are sort of divided into two classes. One is knowledge, and one is behavior. And for the purposes of the presentation today, I'm just going to be focusing on the behavioral outcomes, but I'd be happy to return to the knowledge issue as well if people are interested. So there were two variables that we wanted to measure. One is the use of protection, and we have sort of two alternative measures to get at this. One is the regularity of protection use, recorded as never, sometimes, or always. And a second alternative measure we use for that is we ask subjects to recall the last time that they had sexual intercourse and to report whether they used any method of protection. And the second variable is number of sexual partners that the subject had in the previous month. So the field experiment works like this. We have randomization occurring at two levels. So at the beginning, subjects are randomly assigned to either get the short code for the SMS counseling service or not. Nishaori was the name of the counseling service. So if you don't get the short code, then you're in the pure control group. So the people who get the short code are invited to text in or submit a question about sexual and reproductive health, any question that they might have, to the number. And when they do text in that first question, then they're randomized a second time into one of three treatment conditions: generic information, personalized information, or personalized information with social cues. So the first group, the generic group, receives a response that contains a generic response to their question. And what I mean by that is that, it's generated through an automated response system. And just to give you a sense of what that looks like, this is an English mock-up of what we had. So let's take the second example on the right side. Somebody texts in, "Can I get AIDS from KISS?" And that would be the response that you would receive on your phone. Very small amounts of the HIV virus have been found in saliva, et cetera, et cetera. And so the idea is that it's trying to approximate the kind of health information that could be found in ordinary places like the health facility or if you visit a VCT site, if you went out and looked for it. So that was the generic information group. The second group is the personalized counseling group. So when a subject texts in a question, they receive a response from a human health counselor. And the response is personalized insofar as if you text the question in text speak, in abbreviated form, you'll receive a response that's also in text speak. And the responses also make clear that it's coming from a health counselor at MISA, which was the local implementing NGO that I worked with. And finally, the third treatment condition, the social cue group. So the intervention here is the same as the personalized group. The subjects here also receive responses from human health counselors, but there's an additional piece of text at the end of the message that says, "Thank you, you've joined hundreds of others in the community that are using information through Nishaori to improve their health." So the key idea here is that the first generic information treatment condition is basically just closing the information gap that might exist. It's really just about access to reliable information. And by contrast, the personalized treatment is about this individualized response that mimics a person-to-person interaction with a health counselor. And for the social cue group, the intuition behind it is that the additional text at the end of the message is aimed at signaling that other people around you are consuming this information actively and using it to adapt their behavior accordingly. So you may be more likely to absorb the information contained in the responses you're getting if you believe that a bunch of people around you are doing the same. So the nice feature about this setup is that even if the people who are self-selecting into treatment by texting that first question are somehow different from people in the control group. Like, maybe they are more risk-averse, or maybe they're just more on top of things. We can still parse out the effects of these different ways of providing information as distinct from these sort of unobserved natural characteristics about the individuals. Okay, so, oh wow, okay, I have to move a little bit more quickly. I can talk a little bit more about the data if people are interested in the Q&A. We have 821 subjects at the end line. It was a pre-post intervention. So, moving on to the results, there's maybe good news and maybe bad news. So the good news is that both the personalization and the social cues had advantages over generic information on both measures of protection use, the regularity measure and the recall measure. But curiously, the subjects assigned to the generic group were not only less likely than the other treatment groups to be using protection, they ended up using less protection than the pure control group, who were never given an opportunity to use the counseling service in the first place. And there's also partial evidence that suggests that treated subjects, and in particular the generic group, sought out additional sexual partners over the course of the study. I want to start with a bit of descriptive data. So this is showing within subject movement on the regularity measure. So the people so if you look at the very far left panel, we'll just focus there. Those are the people who responded that they never used protection during sex at the time of the baseline when we did the survey. And then it's showing us the proportion of those subjects who said never, sometimes, or always at the end line. And so you can see here that the social cue group did really well. The personalization group also did well in minimizing the proportion of never users, and they consistently did better than the generic information people in minimizing never users of protection. We also ran an ordered logit model to confirm these patterns in the descriptive data. And so if you look at the second and third rows, so the personalized treatment group, the substantive interpretation of this would be that the odds of being an always or sometimes user are going to be 1.33 times greater if you're assigned to the personalized group. And for the social cue group, it's 1.6 times greater. And these odds are diminished if you move into the generic category. The same patterns are confirmed with the alternative measure of protection, which again, so asked subjects to recall the last time she had sexual intercourse and tell us whether she used protection. The proportion of subjects responding no at the baseline in the generic group, they just stayed in the no category at the end line as well, whereas we have quite a bit of movement for the social cue group in particular. And given the time constraints, I'm not going to walk through the difference in difference estimation. But I did want to throw the control group up there just to illustrate that the generic group is actually doing quite much worse than the pure control group. And although the experiment was designed for comparisons between the treatment conditions, I think it's quite telling just to see that number there. And finally, there was an increase in the number of sexual partners that subjects had over the previous month. For all of the subjects who were assigned to treatment, but this was particularly true of the generic information subjects. And the pre-post difference for the generic group was a 0.89 difference in the number of sexual partners. And while it's a little weird to think about 89/100th of a sexual partner, we asked about the number of partners in the past month, which isn't a very long time, so we can think of this as a pretty substantive jump. So how do we interpret the results that we're seeing here, in particular this increase in the number of sexual partners? And this was really an unexpected finding, and so I have some ideas of what might be happening here, but I'm just going to caveat this by saying that the data on its own can't quite tell us what exactly is happening. But here are some possible explanations. So the first is that getting factual information about sexual health conferred a false sense of security and it made you feel safer about seeking out additional partners. But it's not very straightforward why this would happen to just the generic information people and not the individuals in the other treatment conditions. Another possible explanation is what Jameson, Carlin, and Raffler talk about in their 2013 paper, a sexual sorting mechanism. So they conducted interviews in Uganda and find that when married women are given more information about sexual health, they tell their husbands to go get tested and remain faithful to them. And when the husbands refuse, the wives would say, well, then we are not having sex. The husbands would in turn go out and seek sexual gratification elsewhere, and they call this the sexual sorting mechanism. So this might be going on here, but again, it's not clear why this would be particularly pronounced for the generic category. Yet another possible explanation is that it's not really about people behaving differently, but the way people are answering at the end line. So perhaps by the, you know, this was a long period that the study was ongoing for almost 2 years. So by the end line, maybe people were more accurate or more exaggerated in their self-reports. And finally, another possible explanation is that there was something distinctive about the generic information treatment that undermined the perceived quality of the information that subjects were getting. So if you're in the generic group and you're getting all this information about HIV transmission, say, and you think that the information is of low quality or maybe it's kind of extraneous, there's a lot of extra stuff in there that you don't really want, you might deliberately ignore the content of that information and even act counter to it. So that's another possible explanation. And I think there's much more to be said here, but I just want to conclude. To return to our original question, does it matter how the information is delivered? I think the answer is a resounding yes. It matters a great deal. Personalized information can be a more efficacious way of nudging people in the right direction compared to non-personalized methods. And social cues had this quite dramatic additional impact despite the subtlety of the cue that we used in this particular intervention. So it's quite possible that content push can be helped by ensuring that there's a strong social cue component to it, but I think we need to do further research on how these social cues really operate. And I hate to end a presentation by saying all of this depends, but if there's one thing that you take away from the presentation today, it's not just that how you deliver the information matters a lot, but it's that it can lead to quite divergent outcomes that are really hard to foresee even after lots of focus groups and iterations and prototyping and things like that. And also difficult to observe if you're not looking carefully or in the right places. So with that word of caution, I think I'll stop here and take questions. I look forward to your comments. Thank you.
Time for a few questions.
Thanks very much. Very interesting study. It strikes me that you've got within your data, possibly, I don't know, another indicator, because I was thinking about the generic stuff. Mm-hmm. And if you're getting this kind of generic response, then there's a question about how much you're going to use that. Whereas if you think you're getting a response from a human being, then you might be developing a relationship with that human being and you might use the system more. So does your data tell you anything about the degree, you know, the number of times that those different groups used the service?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I do have data on the frequency and also the timing of the messages, because we might be concerned that maybe people who are texting more, the effects would be different for them, right? And it turns out that the frequency and timing didn't matter in a statistically significant way. We had a bit of a sort of a So when the intervention started, you would see people texting quite a bit, and then it, you know, that's to be expected. And then it kind of levels out. And the average number of interactions for the users was, I think, around 15 interactions, I'm sorry. So that comes out to about, what, a little more than once every 2 months, which is also expected because it's not every day that you're going to have a burning question about how to use a condom or how STDs are transmitted. So I'm not sure if that gets to your question. So I think the first part of your question had to do about how you're going to react if you know that it's coming from a human counselor.
It just was, right? Was there any variation between the three treatment groups in the amount that they used the service?
No. No. That's the short answer, yeah.
Yeah, that's clear.
So one very quick clarification and then sort of a substantive question on along similar lines. The first is, am I correct in thinking that personalization just meant you matched the sort of style of the response, nothing further?
Yeah, so I should be a little clearer about that. So we matched the style, and then the message concluded by saying that it was from a MISA counselor. And MISA stands for Matara Youth Sports Association, which is the local NGO based in Matara. And they have an HIV/AIDS awareness program, counseling program, in-person counseling program that they've been running for several years already. And so that was just supposed to signal that there's a person behind these messages. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so a couple things. I mean, mm-hmm. But if they're using it 15 times on average, they're probably going to pick up the fact that it's not actually too personalized, right? And sort of a more open-ended question is similar, like, is there heterogeneity in the treatment effect by what people are actually asking? Right, like.
Right, the content of the questions. So I looked at what people were actually asking, and it's possible to actually come up with a list of a few standard questions. People weren't asking a very wide variety of things. The most common question that people asked was, can I get AIDS from something? And that they'd have an activity there. My boyfriend or my girlfriend has AIDS, what should I do? Those were quite common. How do I use a condom? And you know, I haven't looked at, I haven't made any dummy fixed effects for the content of the questions. That's something I'll have to look at. But my sense is that there aren't any heterogeneous effects depending on the type of question that people asked. Yeah.
Hi. So I have a couple questions about your methods and the interpretation.
Sorry.
Have a couple questions about your method and the interpretation of your results.
Sure.
So if I understand correctly, what you're presenting are intention to treat estimates.
I'm sorry?
So you are presenting intention to treat estimates.
Yes.
They are not average treatment effects. And I mean, 0.89 reduction in the number of sexual partners seems very large for an intentional treat, because if you consider the take-up, then it's going to go a lot larger than that.
Yeah.
So my question is, are you worried about self-report in this case? Because if I have been exposed to an intervention telling me, use condoms, use condoms, use condoms, then 2 years later I'm going to come back, and even if people have had unprotected sex, they're not going to report it to you because it's just as easy as saying, yes, my last sexual relationship, I was using protection. So. And then have you collect, like what usually people do is collect more hard evidence, like pregnancies, unwanted pregnancies, and that use that as a proxy of contraception and using being protected during sex. And my second question is, I mean, the other research on like sexual campaigns, like, and you might be aware of this work, like Pascaline Dupas, who's also at Stanford, she has shown that even when she didn't find effects on the intensive margin of sexual partners, but on the composition of your sexual partners. So teenage girls were much more likely to disengage in sexual relationship with older men and start doing that with younger boys their age. And then that had a huge impact on HIV prevalence.
Right, okay, great. Thank you for those questions. So I think I will take Your second question first, Pascaline's work that she did with HIV/AIDS awareness. So what Pascaline Dupont did was provide information to girls, adolescent girls at a girls' school about the relative risk associated with having a sexual partner that that was much older, so in their 30s or 40s. And when girls found out that they knew that there it was riskier to partner with older men, then we saw them shifting away from these older partners to younger partners. That's the study that you're referring to, correct? Okay. This was actually part of the motivation for thinking that providing information about sexual health can work in the same way. If people find out about these risks through SMS, then we can curb risky behavior. Turns out it didn't happen for the generic category people, and you know, interpreting the results that we see here is, I'd love to talk with you more about that. And your first question was about self-reported measures. Obviously, they're not ideal. We know that self-reported measures can be highly unreliable, especially for a topic like sexual health. People want to answer in ways that they think they should be answering, right? I thought about using some behavioral measures. You used pregnancy. I was thinking of clinic visits, which data which I have, again, they're self-reported, but clinic visits and also actually administering STD tests on the subjects. But it was just too invasive, and we were also limited by resources, and we couldn't rely on these behavioral measures. What maybe would be possible is to look for sort of aggregate data on health clinic visits and see if that matches up with the kinds of things that we're seeing in the survey data. But coming back to the core of your question. So what we're finding is that people are reporting that they had more sexual partners, right, at the end line compared to the baseline. And so I'm not exactly sure why being told you should be using condoms or you should be doing this and that would lead them to report that they're... I'm not sure if I understood that part of your question. You would think that they would say, oh, I've been faithful and I've had one partner, I've been using condoms consistently.
No, I mean, my point is, you know, like, my point was, your estimate is large as an intentional treat. If mm-hmm. you calculate the average treatment effect of that, it's going to be a lot larger. Especially if your take-up was, you know, not particularly high.
Sure, yeah. I'd love to talk with you about the methods offline. Yeah, that would be great.
We're about
I'm
out
sorry,
of time,
I know
so
we're
that's a good segue.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you to our speakers.